good afternoon, everybody. 打断一下哈，真的有人要听我吗？ 那先解释一下啊，这个小弟我是听到说八鬼一城嘛，我想说怎么可能有八鬼一城？你八鬼一城我就给你投八篇那个提案嘛哈，没想到就上次思辨，所以这是为什么一直出现原因哈。好，然后那个当初勾错了，不小心勾到这个 English 哈，所以我们就用英文来讲了哈。好，So I'm so nervous 啊 ，OK。 So I'm going to talk about Xvisor, which is embedded library hypervisor. This area the part I would like to talk, including the memory, MNU, interrupt control, clock, timer, instruction set, and the peripherals. Yep, because virtualization is a matter of everything. So we want to narrow down the scope. So I will discuss some concept and Xvisor for ARM, especially for ARM, and the device of virtualization. So let's talk about the concept. If you try to figure out the CPU performance since 1960s and until right now, you can see the ARM server, ARM mobile phone, and the related devices are capable to virtualize in much cheaper and powerful way. And the reason why you should try to know about operating system level virtualization is OS itself is not perfect. If you consider the compatibility, stability, and security, and you will know that it's limitation. For example, if you want to implement fast boot, I mean the faster boot based on hibernation approach, because kernel Linux kernel itself cannot swap itself. But if you use a under layer we call hypervisor, you can use hypervisors to swap almost everything, so that you can make the hibernation more stable and much faster. And also, there is another consideration is legacy OS support, especially for large third-party software products. So that is a typical usage for 3G, 3G mobile phone. You can see in the past, you need two CPUs. But if you use the hypervisor, you can make the different operating system on one core, single core. And there are two type of approach for virtualization. Type one is bare metal hypervisor. Another is hosted. So for type one, the example is almost a microkernel base or some special hypervisor, for example, Zen. For type two, the classical example are VMware, KVM, and Hyper-V. So here we call hyper virtualization is a property of instruction set architecture, which is ISA. So we have to consider two kinds of instruction. One is a sensitive instruction, another is a privileged instruction. For sensitive instruction, it changes the configuration or mode for the processor. And for the privileged instruction, it must be executed in sufficient privilege. Otherwise, it causes a trap in user mode. So if all sensitive instructions are privileged, virtual machine monitor can be written. That is a key concept for virtualization. So let's think about the protective mode in Intel architecture. So as you know, there are some privileged rings from ring 0, ring 1, ring 2, to ring 3. So if you want to insert a layer, here we call VNN, virtual machine monitor. The whole operating system will run on ring 1, ring 2, or other more, which means you will encounter the problem for the privilege instruction, and you have to take care about sensitive instructions. So there is a common technique we call trap and emulate. The approach is try to execute guess in separate address space in unprivileged mode, and emulate all instructions that cause trap. So if you check on instruction, at least for on version 4, there are some instructions, for example, branch, data processing, switch, shift, and even coprocessor. So among these instructions, there are some cases which cause problem. We will encounter some types. So we can conclude three types. The type one is instruction which is good in user mode will cause undefined instructions, especially for the coprocessor case. And for the type two, instruction which is good in user mode will have no impact. For example, if you try to obtain the value or set value for CPSR, SPSR in user mode, it has no effort at all. And the last one is instruction which is good in user mode will cause unknown behavior. For example, if you try to change a program counter with the value of a linked register, so it will cause unpredictable behavior when you execute in user mode, because linked register is not only change in user mode, but also other part for kernel part. So this is a limited list for unsensitive instruction. For example, on coprocessor, SYNC, trust zone, CPSR, indirect CPSR, and some bank register access instruction, for example, multiple load, multiple store, because ARM has only one user mode, and more than five privilege mode. So if you are in user mode or other mode, for example, FIQ mode, the multiple load store instruction or multiple data access mode will fail. So the solution for this instruction can be concluded in two ways. One way is hardware techniques, and another way is software techniques. So for hardware technique, you can see you can change the instruction at runtime. So you can use a tracer debug support. And for the latest on hardware, there is a hardware assisted virtualization. For example, HYP, which means hypervisor mode in ARM, called as A15. So you can check there is a special mode we call HYP mode, which is a hardware technique to handle such problem. And for software techniques, there are major two kinds solution. One kind is binary translation, another kind is hypercall. And binary translation is designed is cost was higher than hypercall, but its compatibility is much better. And your guest always might not have to change. So it's a basic idea. If you encounter sensitive instruction, you can change the sensitive instruction at runtime. Please note, for ARM instruction, which has a fixed instruction size, this operation can be done immediately. And if you use hypercall techniques, you have to modify the operating system image in advance in order to make the sensitive instruction to be replaced by a specific software interval or some hypercall handler. So you have to change the original code to this before the operating system is being executed. So About to talk about Xvisor, which is a lightweight and embedded hypervisor to overcome the virtualization issues. Xvisor itself is type 1 hypervisor and licensed under GPL. Its mission is to bring a lightweight, portable, and flexible solution for small memory footprint and less virtualization overhead. And its performance is good enough. You can check the number. So you can compare the D MIPS scope. So for native Linux, you can get the number, and up to virtualize, number is very near. So it's about 6% slowdown. And there are two major targets. One is Intel architecture, another is ARM. We will talk about only ARM architecture in this talk. So for ARM targets, it already support ARM9, ARM11, Cortex-A9, Cortex-A8, and ARM Cortex-A15, as long as virtualization is tension. So the technique that Xvisor use is try to modify the sensitive instruction if you don't have the virtualization extension. So there is a special script called EF2C patch Python script. It will encode privilege instruction into SVC. So it means you repress all privilege instruction in special call sequence with a specific interval handler. And it will change the image. I mean, guest OS image. So the real OS you plan to execute is the patch in image. So if you check SWI, WFI, which means wait for interval. So if you check the Linux source code, the original Linux source code, there is a WFI instruction. But if you use a cpatch tool, you can see there is no privilege instruction, and you only have no more unprivileged instruction. And you have to consider other case. For example, if you want to couple with a coprocessor, you have to decode, to interpret and encode the sequence. So if you use MSR register, which try to read from register and set the value to PSR, and original the instruction in user mode has no effect. So the cpatch Python script will change its encoding and make it use hypercall. So the original MSR is replaced by a specific hypercall. So Xvisor utilize cpatch to convert privilege or some problematic instruction to OS image files. But it's not enough, because you have to handle virtual CPU memory and even device driver and performance issues. So if you try to boot on Linux under Xvisor, you can check the boot sequence. You can check the above. So Xvisor, the message Xvisor is start, you can see Xvisor is initial sound pass, so Xvisor timer is ready. And it will kickstart Linux kernel for the guest OS. So initially, Xvisor try to initialize some hardware and then load the guest image. And you might want to load another Linux image as another guest OS. And Xvisor itself is basically a real-time operating system, and the thread in Xvisor is a virtual CPU. So you can see virtual CPU itself is a thread binded to specific on CPU. So if you have a multi-core or other complex configuration, the thread will be dispatched to specific CPUs. And the Xvisor provide a priority-based time slicing schedule policy. And the guest OS know nothing about Xvisor, which means you can use unmodified guest OS for Xvisor usage. This is very important because Xvisor, the performance of Xvisor is getting better and better. And its mission is try to run unmodified guest OS. And if you use virtualization extension, the performance is near native. And besides that, you will encounter another issues. Let's consider WFI again. If you try to execute WFI instruction, there are two conditions. If virtualization extension is enabled or present for your CPU, WFI is configured to trap into hypervisor mode. And for non-virtualization extension cases, WFI is convert single SW code during boot time, so it's only single hyper code. And you can see during the boot stage, there is an extra script to convert the memory layout, because you have to consider the cache. Please keep in mind that Xvisor itself has different MNU configuration other than virtual MNU configuration used by guest OS. So you have to adjust the memory layout. So you can see the memory base layout have to align to 1 mega boundary. And after you enable MNU and map virtual address, so you have to change the base address. And Xvisor you utilize body allocator, which is the same algorithm used by Linux kernel. So please keep in mind that you have to consider this case. So if you want to write a hypervisor or want to know how a hypervisor works, you have to handle the memory, especially for the privilege cases. So in Xvisor, the memory layout is described in device tree. And you can see this part. Device tree is a common technique used by several broader Linux kernel and some Linux-based projects. So you want to describe the information, for example, starting program counter and guess physical address, host physical address, and guess physical address. So if you configure these attributes in device tree, Xvisor will read the device tree and try to configure and set the MNU both for the PA, physical address, and the virtual address. And for the device virtualization, you have to consider more cases other than MNU. So the problem of the technique you have to think is you will be try to face is user space driver device emulation. And even more, you have to consider the paravirtualized device drivers. We also call the VirtIO in Linux kernel terminology. So for the latest Xvisor, it already supports VirtIO, which is the same API as same as KVM and QENU. So it means it is possible to reuse the virtualized networking stack, virtualized driver, and even more device infrastructure by Xvisor, so that you can emulate more guest OS image or more devices under Xvisor. So we discussed vCPU before. vCPU itself is just a thread in the manner of Xvisor. And it will talk about, the guest OS will utilize VirtIO to handle link buffer, to handle the worker threads, which connect to the physical parts. And there are even more memory start table, which can reduce the number which you want to look at the devices. And device virtualization itself is described in device tree as well. So you can see the thread that more and more ARM-based projects utilize device tree already. So this is an example configuration. You can see there is an entry called GIC0. GIC0, it means generic interrupt controller, which is present for ARM version 7. Okay, so you configure the device for the first part is the type virtual, which means you use a VirtIO framework, and you can dispatch the interrupt from the physical to virtual, and you will utilize GIC to dispatch the interrupt simultaneously. So you can reserve special device region, and as wise we will set up MNU mapping with a special attribute that no rewrite permission in the patch table. And every time the guest program access a device memory, a patch fault is triggered, and the CPU will jump into the data for handler. So this time, what I framework will try to take over other handling after your data for handling. So you can write some special entries either for Xvisor itself, or you can use some shadow device emulation in Xvisor. So if you implement interface, so you can bind a virtual UART, and the guest OS will trap into virtual UART after your patch for handle is activated. And for another guest OS is similar. So you can use a special technique if you want to make the special purpose, for example, multi-gigabit throughput. So for the networking, it's possible to utilize the latest VirtIO improvements. So if you check the Linux kernel, the latest Linux kernel, there are already some mechanism called vhostnet. So this is another plan that Xvisor trying to implement to collaborate with the Linux kernel developer to make the device emulation framework more complete. Okay. And this is the reference. You can check the first one is which is written in Chinese also. So it's a National Taiwan University lectures. And you can check if you check the user menu from ARM, you can see ARM virtualization. This is presented by VMware. This is a very good material about the virtualization. And if you are interested in the virtualization extension, and if you want to know GIC or other memory, memory extension, you can share this presentation 2 years ago. Okay, so do you have any question?
I'd like to ask about...
You want to use the microphone?
Microphone, I took it. 跑 Cortex M 的程式码的话，有没有办法用这个东西来做到？那是怎么做？那假如说，例如说，可能，或者说有些状况说可能没有，我们有个 Cortex M 3的处理器，想要跑 M 4的程式码，那有没有这样子的资源？谢谢。
以 Cortex M 系列的话呢，其实以前有，以前啊，好了，我承认是。 我很早还在写的时候有这个样的东西的哈，就是比方说那个 Codex M 的话，它有一个比较大的问题是它的执行集是不同的，它是 Sum2 嘛，就是它是 Sum2 的指令，所以在目前的 SY 则啊是没有做 Sum2 的，哎 Sum2 就是你必须要把那个 Sum2 的 handle 把它做完，然后再是像 Codex M。 比方说 Codex M 0的话，它是 on v6 嘛，所以在我们两年前我们有去做这一块，但是没有做完。那如果你把这些东西都补完的话呢？好，对啊，反正你暑假没有结束嘛，所以你如果把它补完的话呢，那其实就有机会跑啊。但是这是一个很有趣的事情，你可以想象说 Codex M 的那个一小段比较 free autos 跑在哪里？跑在你的Pineapple 或是 Codex A9 或是那个号称有 A15 等级的一个手机上，好，这是有可能的，在 SY 的是可以做的哈。那只是说现在有缺很多东西，比方说像 Sum2 那个 instruction 的模拟，好，这是还没有做完的。那这也表示说 Android 目前在上面是不能跑。如果你把这段补完的话呢，好，那当然像刚才那个 C patch 你要是需要去修改，那你补完的话其实是可以用的。对，所以暑假有目标，对不对？好，很好，好，谢谢。
Right.
And, yes.
Okay.
I like the page.
That program just tried to convert the privileged instruction to a user mode instruction.
Yep.
I know you are also an LVM expert, compiler expert. So is it possible to modify the LVM backend and generate this user mode instruction directly? What problem we will encounter if we want to try this? Yes.
Can I answer in Chinese?
哦 ，Sure，
哦，太好了，啊，那这件事其实已经有人做了，在好像是3年前就有人做了吧，对啊，哎，但是成效都不太好，对啊，我没有 follow 最新的发展，对，那我有听说交大那个 KVN on 那个 team 嘛，就是那个 KVN on 的 team， 他们有在做这一段，但是我不知道效果是怎样，因为我很久没有去 follow 了，对，那这但是这个 case 对 SY 是没有效的，因为 SY 就是要避开这件事。 他不做这些 optimization， 他就是 single pass 直接弄过去，对他甚至连 runtime profile 都没有。对。我想问一下，有用多久 GIC 吗？对啊，他是 virtual GIC 啊，已经实作进去了，在3个月前已经实作进去了。
哦，因为刚刚的影片叙述，我以为看起来比较像是 virtIO 里面的。 Virtual GIC 不是 Howard 他提供那个 Virtual GIC
因为两个其实都要做。对，因为你不能只光靠那个 Howard 的 GIC。对啊，因为 Hypervisor 本身要能够 run 嘛，所以他自己还要能够。哦，所以你们也是有把
Virtual GIC
的东西用进去。就是在3个月前就有做一部分的这样，但还有很大的改进空间啊，因为包含效率，还有一些就是跟 Linux driver 真的要重用那些。 code，你在 SY 里面会看到一大堆从那个 Linux kernel 干来，不是从那个借来的code这样子哈。我的私聊不能乱讲话啊，就是借来的 code。那现在目标就其实是希望可以直接重用，就像 U-boot 那样子，可以尽可能去重用 Linux 的 kernel 的。SY的社群啊，我记得在一年前我看的时候，好像有去跟
KVN 社群沾一件事情，就是他们 on 的版本比哥伦比亚大学做那个 on 的版本跑起来效能还要好。你知道为什么有可能会比它好吗？
这么说好了哈，要比哥伦大学的版本好，实在太容易了。<笑>我们清大的学生随便做一做哈，认真用个一年多，就比人家做2年的东西好了哈。毕竟我觉得是途径是不同的啊。哥伦比亚大学他们是一个比较通用的途径，他们在意是他们要想要定个 framework， 但是对于细节，比方说 cache validation 这件事，就是 invalidation 的话，这件事在早期甚至是不做的。 对啊，所以你看到哥伦比亚大学第一个版本，在要模拟一个 BigQuery 就开机要开10分钟，长到没办法 demo， 对不对？啊，就是我觉得是 想法是不同的，但是哥伦比亚大学他们有一个好处，就是他们跟社群是走得比较近的 ，community 是吃那一套的，好，然后所以李娜罗现在有一些开一些职缺嘛，你可以去 apply 哈，就是在把这个东西补完，对，那所以 Xvisor 现在其实现在目标也是尽可能去重用这些成果了，因为你看像那个 VHostNet 啊，这一月其实改蛮多的，这在那个 OpenStack 嘛 ，Red Hat 还有那个 Oracle 那一票人。努力投入之后，现在整个 network 都完全是，也不能叫面目全非，反正就是跟原本架构已经完全不同了，就是真正做出zero copy 了，对吧、啊？这已经是完全不同的世界了，对吧、啊？那像 Xvisor 其实如果不做这条路的话，他就只能很苦命的把这东西周边慢慢补完了，对啊。哎，所以就是你看最新的 code 现在有一部分 VirtIO 可以 run， 但是 network 还是不行。network 的话现在还是比较麻烦，还是先走底层那个 live IP 这个途径这样。好
好，那
thanks for everybody, thanks for coming, thank you.